a long story, and it started when I was 9 years old, and what, Steve, maybe 5 years old, and I just learned computer technology and logic and ones and zeros. There were no books anywhere. You couldn't learn it on the internet. I stumbled into a journal here and there, and I said, this is what I'm going to love for the rest of my life. Didn't think of it as a job. I didn't even think of it as engineering. Engineering, I was a ham radio operator back then when I was 10 years old, and that was how you hook up all the parts and do the mathematics and make things work and radios, you know. The old day, engineering. I didn't think computers were engineering. Computers were in these weird places called research, you know, or factories or companies or military. So, but anyway, as I progressed through, I did all the science fair projects that won huge awards. I would be in eighth grade and I'd win the award for a Bay Area Science Fair all the way up to 12th graders in electronics. So I was one of those premier people. I'd never have to worry about a job coming out of high school. I was just so advanced in both analog electronics and the digital stuff I taught myself. By high school, I saw a manual that described the insides of a computer, the architecture, and I said, I wonder if I went back to my elementary school science fair projects with these little things called logic gates that I learned to build out of transistors. Could I design, maybe using chips, could I design a computer? And it took months at first. You work and you don't know how to do it, you figure it out. No books told me how to do it. So by the end of high school, I was every weekend, I would go in and get a manual for a new computer, IBM, Varian, Hewlett Packard, and I would design it. I got to where I could design any computer in the world in about 2 days. Wow. There were some complicated computers that would take more. And I just did it. I didn't think I'd ever have a job in designing computers. And then, of course, I went through college, and I told my dad, like my first year of college, I am someday going to own a 4K mini computer. Why 4K bytes? Seems small now, but that was the minimum you needed to type in programs, to solve puzzles, to solve games, to solve problems. What I'd love to do with computers, 4K, my dad said it cost as much as a house. And with the input out, and I was stunned, and I said, I'll live in an apartment. A goal is much more important than knowledge. I had a lot of knowledge, but a goal, I want something. And I had great jobs designing the hottest products in the world, and I would design first things that there were no movies in hotels yet. And a guy in Hollywood wanted to build a movie in hotel system, and I got to design it. And I charged him, well, I worked at Hewlett Packard, designing the hottest product of the day, the scientific calculators. I would take these side jobs, and I would always charge 5 cents. That was my pay, because I loved it so much. When I was in college, I would type term papers on the old school typewriters. From midnight till 6:30 in the morning, I would type them for other people. Always charge 5 cents. You love something, that's how you are to it. So I was, so here it was. I spotted when the parts got to the right price, and you could build at a price a human could afford. I could afford, with no money, no savings accounts in the bank, nothing like that. I could afford a computer that was useful. So of course I built it. Now Steve Jobs wasn't around. He was out of town. For about 5 years before Apple, the day I met him, I showed him all my Bob Dylan albums and the liner notes and the lyrics and all that. We had a big fun part of our life between concerts, pranks, jokes, running around, little blue boxes that could make phone calls everywhere in the world. We had quite a life just like normal young kids, you know, young 20s or less. And Steve wasn't around. He was at a commune in Oregon. About once a year he'd been coming into town. He would see the latest thing that I designed for fun. A little pong game I built myself. I designed a breakout for Atari, actually. And he'd see these things and he'd always turn them into money for us. He was the money person because he had zero money. I had a job. He had zero money. So he had to get every little bit of thing that I designed. He would always turn into a few hundred bucks for us. And he didn't know that I had designed this first computer. I was in a club of people that talked. We had university professors that would talk about once we had our own computers, we would communicate so fast that you could type a message and within 1 hour, 100 people could read it. Okay. And education would be all different because you'd answer questions to get told immediately right or wrong. Immediacy of reward and punishment is very important in psychology. If your dog poops on the floor, you don't whack it on the head by the poop 12 hours later, it doesn't work. So that was going to be, education was going to be improved. And we little geeks who knew how to program computers would take them into our companies, type in the company financial numbers, pop out the strategies for the company. We'd be more important than the CFO just because we knew computers. I loved those. It was like a revolution. Every young person, you know, wants to change things that are so wrong in the world, government, whatever, and they want to be part of a revolution. And that was mine. It was technical. So I built this computer. I brought it down to the club. Steve wasn't around. And I gave away all the designs. For free. No copyrights or anything. I wanted to help these other people to have a design that they, for $300, they could build a useful computer. And everybody looking over my shoulder saw the formula for how you build a personal computer with a keyboard, video screen, and some chips that are actually doing the video as well. That was the formula, and then Steve Jobs came into town. He came in to visit Kentucky once in a while, and the movie with Ashton Kutcher shows him taking me to a computer club. That's a bunch of baloney. He'd never been to the club. I've been there every day since it started. I was a hero at the club showing off my computer every 2 weeks. So I took him down to the club to show him what it was about, and he saw all the interest, and that's when he said, we should start a company. Well, he and I had been doing business together for 5 years, and started the company. I had one big problem. I had made up my mind that I would be an engineer for life, hardware, software, designing things. That was my life, and I would never move up into management. I didn't want to run things. I didn't want to get political. Didn't want to have to take sides. I just wanted to do great creative work. And I would be an engineer for life at Hewlett-Packard. Hewlett-Packard back then built the test equipment all engineers used. So we engineers were designing the stuff that we ourselves wanted, so we totally knew what was good and bad. And I loved it there, and I would never risk losing a job at Hewlett-Packard by starting another company. So I went and proposed to my boss and the group leader and the section leader above him and the lab manager, all in one big meeting, a bunch of marketing people. And I proposed it, and I got turned down for the first of 5 times. Hewlett-Packard, big companies, just couldn't see any money, any revenues in this small computer as a business. They just couldn't justify it because they were smart about them. So Steve and I were in business. And our first idea, we had no money. What do you do when you're in your young 20s? You have no money, you have no business experience at all. What do? You do with what you can. And Steve's idea was not to build computers. He wasn't quite a computer person builder. It was to build this little fiberglass board called a PC board that other people could plug their chips into that they get from their companies or wherever. Plug chips into, solder it up, and they'd be able to build my computer a lot faster than hooking up every wire themselves and cutting wires and doing all the stuff I had done to design it. So that was the idea. We'd build these boards for $20, we'd sell them for $40. We had no money. I had to sell my most valuable possession, my Hewlett-Packard 65 calculator. Steve sold a little van home, got a few $100 to pay a guy to design the PC board, and if we sold 50, we'd make a profit. And we might not sell 50, but we'd be a company who once in our lives we could call ourselves company. And that was the start of the early Apple, but Apple had 2 stars. And that start had a third person. Steve had 45%. It was a partnership. He had 45%, I had 45%. And we hired a kind of an adult guy who'd been around the block a while. He's an arch, we call him a libertarian today, back then because different words, but he sort of had been in business and he knew things. He was an adult and he could answer questions. So we trusted him to resolve any disputes. Ron Wayne, but after a few weeks he sold out his 10% of Apple for a few $100. That was the first start of Apple. Now we're getting up to a garage. We didn't have a company in a garage, but we had a garage. When you have no money, you have to work at home. And eventually you go out to the garage. If you're going to build things, you go to the garage. We started on the kitchen table, of course, and Steve's bedroom would stock up some boxes and things, and that's how you start. But we didn't have a company. Like, a company is like where Hewlett-Packard started in a garage. It's a famous story we told in Silicon Valley. And they had desks and workplaces and phones and manuals and everything you need in a company. All the, you know, pens and pencils and paper and all that stuff. So we were in the garage, but we used the garage about 3 hours a week. We never did any talking about computers in the garage, never decided what features they should have. We never did any engineering in the garage. We never did any building up, prototyping in the garage. We never did any manufacturing in the garage. Our boards were manufactured somewhere else. And eventually we got a big order, so we got chips already in the boards. We would drive up to the house once a week and out the garage, hook them up one at a time to make sure they worked, and fix the ones that needed fixing. And then Steve would get them and put them in the car and drive them down to the one computer store in the whole Silicon Valley area, the bike shop in Mountain View, and they would pay us cash. We got all the parts on 30 days credit, built up the board so fast we had no lawyers to go through and no big management to, you know, delay things. Within 10 days, we got paid cash for them. So we actually could build a little bank account and got to, sold about 100 computers or more and got the bank account up to over $10,000, just all on our own. But before we ever shipped the Apple One, we were demonstrating the product that would change the world and make a big company. The Apple One wasn't designed by me as a computer. It was hastily modified terminal to get on the early network that only had 6 computers in the United States, MIT, Stanford Research Institute, UCLA, UC Santa Barbara, and 2 others. It had 6 computers, and I could log on, and I could run programs, and I could actually read files. And I built this terminal, but it went over the phone line to talk to a computer far away over slow modem tones. And then when I saw the formula for building a portable computer, I hastily added the brains, a microprocessor chip that had just come out that summer, and dynamic memory, 4K light, that had just come out that summer, and just made it an affordable computer, but it wasn't designed as a computer to begin with. It was modified from something designed for slow operation over phone lines. So the Apple II was the real hit. The Apple II, I put all of my expertise in the world, and I had a reputation for designing things with fewer parts than anyone else. The PhDs at Hewlett-Packard were often called our division and asked me to take one of their designs over and come up with a solution if they had 57 transistors, like doing it 11. So I had that reputation for designing things very efficiently, and the Apple II, so many ideas came in my head. First of all, it was the first time ever I loved games. I loved playing games, and arcade games were just being started by Atari. They were all black and white televisions. They were all hardware designs, meaning a skilled engineer like myself could spend up to a year making a prototype that worked. Up to a year, just putting wires between chips to make signals go up and down. This was not like today, where a game is a program. You tell something to move from, you know, from 5,10 to 5,20, and it moves. The Apple II was the first time ever. Well, first of all, color cost they didn't have any color games in the arcades. It cost $5,000 with all this heavy mathematics, differential calculus, and that kind of stuff to design special little feedback loops that treated waveforms like waves. You know, sometimes you'll see this in books, waveforms like out of the wall socket. If they're at the right speed, it would represent red. A little later in time, it could represent blue. And I was 4 days and nights without sleep because I had to design Breakout for Atari in 4 days so Steve could have money to move into a comic. And your mind, when you're without sleep, your mind kind of goes off like you're falling asleep or waking up. It goes, drifts off into more unchallenged areas, areas you haven't read in a book. And all of a sudden, I realized if you took a number in memory, and you said you want it to appear, the number 3, you want it to appear as red on a TV, you put it into this device, it costs $5,000 in today's dollars at least. And then something popped in my head. What if these things going up and down? What if I just put ones and zeros, computer numbers, onto a wire? If I put 3 into a place in memory, and the second thing that was important was that memory would correspond to a pixel on the TV, a position on the TV. And if I store in computers, you can always say, store something in location 101, store something in location 102. All those locations were pixels on the TV set. I realized if I took a number, four little ones and zeros, that's 16 possible numbers, and fed that number on a wire to the TV, the way TVs were designed, they would think it was public. Totally illegal, never mention it.
Biology, book of engineering. Your iPhone is exploding.
So, first, one thing first, one last comment. The Apple II was the first time ever that arcade games would be color, and the first time ever that they would be software, where a 9-year-old kid could write a program to say vertical equals 1, vertical equals 2, vertical equals 3, and make colors move on screen. Yeah, I think that's a big step for games. If you had to have games, nobody would buy a computer in the home for inventory levels and sales figures and salaries. No, they had to have fun.
Never ask an engineer how to program a computer.
I think when Boaz said my iPhone.